is the Holy Spirit plain. We have a burning desire to lift up Jesus' name.
Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
Jeremiah chapter 29, reading verse 11. Oh, little guys, I'm sorry. Let the little guys go. Guys, you don't have to wait for me to send you. When I start preaching, you just get up and go. You can make like a banana and split. Hallelujah. Make like a tree and leave. Oh, those are old, aren't they? Yeah, those are old. Boy, it's good to see y'all this morning. How many got blessed past a couple of Sundays? Amen. How many were here Wednesday night? Ooh. My. If that won't make a Pentecost out of you, nothing will. I'm telling you right now, it's good stuff. Hallelujah. Praise be to Jesus. Amen. Now, we talked about Jeremiah 29:11. I know my thoughts toward that I think towards you, saith the Lord. Listen. Have you ever heard people, or you've either developed a narrative of your Christian walk that God's just waiting for you to make a mistake so he can fly swatch you? He's waiting to, you know, oh, I wouldn't say that because God's going to strike you with lightning. Hello? Now, they get some of that from different stories, like, you know, studying the Ark of the Covenant. They weren't allowed to touch it, and the guy died because he touched the Ark of the Covenant. But there's reasons for that beyond he said a cuss word. Amen? Well, because he said a cuss word, the lightning came out and struck him dead. And listen, Raiders of the Lost Ark is inaccurate. Great movie, love the movie, but it's not biblical. My son said it actually happened. It's real documentary footage. I know how Moses felt. What did I do? Hallelujah. Jeremiah 29:11. I know my faults that I think toward you, saith the Lord. Now, what does God think towards us? The Word of God says this, thoughts of peace. Wow. And not, underline it, not of evil. My thoughts towards you, says the Lord, are thoughts of peace and not of evil. You hear some people talk, God's just got the whole world hung out over hell, getting ready to drop you in any second. I know one of the greatest sermons of the 1800s was called Great Revival, the Great Awakening in America, and the sermon was, hey, sinners in the hands of an angry God. If God was angry with all the sin and going to wipe people out because of it, there wouldn't be many folks left right now. California wouldn't exist. Hello? Are you here? You know, God just hold them out over hell and just wait to drop them in. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. He sent Jesus. Then what did the Bible say? While we were all together dead in our trespasses and sins, amen, he quickened us. He made us alive together with Christ and raised us up with him and made us sit with him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. When was that? While we were dead in our trespasses and sins. Hello? He's wooing humanity to the throne. He's wooing humanity to Jesus. He's wooing them by his Spirit. He's calling them. And his thoughts toward humanity are thoughts of peace and not of evil. Are you here? What? To give you, now the King James says, an expected end. Other translation says this, a hope and a future. God sent Jesus to a hopeless world. Without hope, without a covenant with God, without an answer to the Gentiles, there was no hope. You didn't have a covenant. You were just dog sorry toast. But Jesus came. Now, God has a plan for your life. Say it with me. Say, God has a plan for my life. And I got news for you. It's good. It's thoughts of not of thoughts of peace, not of evil, to give me a hope and a future. His plan for my life is a hope and a future. Amen. Now, we started out with this, talking about how that, you know, there's certain things that we have about, you know, finding your destiny in God and walking things out. One of them was there are myths concerning destiny. One is no Bible character ever missed it. It's full of people that missed it. The only Bible character that didn't miss it was Jesus. Everybody else missed it. Hello? And they still got back on track. So all Bible characters knew their destiny from the beginning. No, they didn't. The father of our faith, those who are faith, have the faith of faithful Abraham. Abraham was all messed up. Hello? Lied about his wife. Tried to get God to take his plan instead of God's plan. Oh, that Ishmael might live before you. Hello? Y'all hear you gone home? Took him 25 years to get from Abram to Abraham. Come on now. See, we think, boy, you know, God speaks to us and calls us to something one day, and we are, you know, we are the next, you know, Moses the next. Well, Moses really had it together, didn't he? His first act after finding out he wasn't Egyptian was to go kill some guy. Banished to the backside for 40 years. And was an arrogant, cocky rascal. Everybody else stays away from the mount. He sees the bush burning. I got to go see this thing. He takes off, runs up the mountain. Yeah, I'm Moses. And he gets there and hears a voice says, who are you? He says, he says, Moses. That's what God said, Moses. He said, here I am. Yep, it's me. I'm here. The fun has arrived. Thank you very much. Hello? God says, take your shoes off. The ground you stand on is holy. Moses falls on his face. God has a conversation with him. He says, I'm going to call you. I've heard the cry of my people. I'm going to deliver them. And I'm sending you. And Moses goes, who is it? I mean, he went from here I am to who am I? But he fulfilled his destiny. Amen. Isaiah went from who am I to here I am. God has a way to get us out of the extreme pride and arrogance of ourselves, or the extreme defamation and abasing of ourselves, and get us to the place where we're pliable and useful for the kingdom of God. Amen. Can you say amen? I said, can you say amen? Amen. Now, yeah, there are some folks out there right now that need to come down, and there's some folks that need to be brought up, but we all need to be where God needs us to be. But every single one, God's thoughts toward them give them a hope and a future. Amen. Talked about last week how you've only got one chance to get it right. No, that's not true. You don't have just one chance to get it right. Oh, my goodness. I'm glad some of you, and glad some of you people out there that on the internet, or some of you that have been in our church before, aren't in charge. I'll be honest with you. I'm really glad some of you are not in charge. Because you'd have cooked me a long time ago. Hello? There'd be a place downtown Greensboro where I've been crucified and cooked at the stake, you know, and mummified out there. Because none of us are perfect. None of us have it all together. We're striving to walk out the plan of God. Amen? 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 And as long as you keep your heart pure before God and pursue Him and repent when you mess up, He'll keep dealing. He'll keep working. He'll keep molding you with into the image of Christ. As we learn to put off the old man and put on the new. But it doesn't mean if he called you, you missed it. That's it. It's over. It's done. That was your one shot. My wife's got a friend at work. Every day he goes and buys a lottery ticket at lunch. He's got certain numbers he uses. One day this past week he didn't go. They pulled his number, $50,000. Oh, man, that was my one chance in life. We get so whatever. How many of you have ever been to a car dealership? The deal of a lifetime. You'll never have this shot again as long as you live. Next week, the same deal and better. Hello. We use that all the time on people in the world, the world to manipulate them. This is your one shot. Some of you people that are single, this is my one shot at love. If I don't take this one shot, you may not want that shot. Amen. That one shot may be the worst shot you ever had. Amen. You know, we can't live with that narrative that you got this one chance to get it right. It's not just one chance to get it right with God. God knows your weakness of your flesh. And he strives with you and works with you. And yes, sermons are preached and the word of God's revealed and the Holy Spirit deals with you to mold you and to bring you so that you can more and more day by day put on the image of Christ. Not just born of Christ, but put on the image of Christ. You begin to act more and more like him. Let me tell you something. 3 years after Peter met Jesus, 3 years of walking with him, 3 years after when he walked on the water with Jesus, miracles, signs, and wonders. After 3 years of that, he's still a cussing and denying. And Jesus told him before that at the Last Supper. Well, it was the Last Supper of the Passover meal under that covenant. The new meal was the Lord's table. Liturgical churches refer to it as the Holy Eucharist. Okay? Communion, the Holy Eucharist, the Lord's table, all referring to the same thing. We're communing with Christ by the breaking of bread and the drinking of the blood. It is not literally turned into the blood of Jesus. I know people teach that. That's not biblical. It represents it. His blood's on the mercy seat. That's right, every drop of it. Hello. Amen. Where was I going? He's sitting there at that meal, and he tells Peter, he says, I've prayed for you that after you're converted, you'll strengthen the brethren. And Peter's like, man, what's going on here? What do you mean to pray for me that after I'm converted? I'm with you, Lord. I've already, listen, you're going to deny me twice before three times before the cock crows twice. You can get in three denials. Finally, the last time they said, yeah, but your speech does betray you. In other words, he had started talking like Jesus. A blankety blank, 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 blank. I don't know him. We're not going to fill in the blanks. Okay? You don't even use your imagination. He cursed. And then he went out and wept bitterly. But then he was strengthened. And on the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Ghost fell, and they were all baptized in the Holy Ghost and began to speak in tongues, he stumbled out on that balcony and preached in front of thousands of people. That sermon that started the church, glory to God, with over 3,000 people got saved in that. Whoa, glory to God. All of a sudden, you know, Peter who lied and denied the Lord who died, he lied and denied the Lord who died. Upon Mount Calvary, I'm sorry, Mother Goose nursery rhyme songs. Don't be a chicken like Peter was, for he lied and denied the Lord who died upon Mount Calvary. Because Peter sure was a chicken. Amen. But soon became a man. Because Peter the chicken. Anyway. Sorry, that just kind of came out. Forgive me. Anyway, it tells you how many times I listened to that nursery rhyme. Hello, kids remember that one, don't they? Nathan even remembers it, don't you, buddy? Yep. Now it's in your head. Kind of like I did to Shannon for a week there. You know, every time she turned around, I'd just send little text messages. Henry the Eighth, I am. Anyway, that song would just get in her head. She'd say, don't do that to me. No, but Peter didn't have one chance to get it right. The Lord knew. He said, the person that dips salt with me is going to deny me. And yet he even knew that the man who had been with him for 3 years that stood by said, cut off the guy's ear. Peter doesn't cuss the guy's ear off. Jesus makes him go and get the ear. Go get that ear, Peter. Bring it over here. And slaps it back on the guy's head and heals him. That probably messed Peter up. You know? He's going, we're going to fight. But God knew that, he, you know, even though like he had one shot, he thought maybe he had one shot, you don't have one shot. I mean, we talked about that last week, how the Mark was brought back. Hallelujah. That Paul said, bring Mark back over in 2 Timothy 4:11. He's now profitable for me to the ministry. Years before, he was so unprofitable, it broke up the Barnabas and Paul ministry team. Evangelistic Association. BPEA, the Barnabas and Paul Evangelistic Association got broke up. because Mark, because Barnabas wanted Mark, Paul didn't want him, and split the whole team up. But years later, Paul says, bring him. He's profitable. God can make you profitable no matter how bad you've missed it. For the kingdom. He can bring you back and restore you and make you profitable. Glory to God. I said glory to God. Hallelujah. Amen. So how do we find our destiny in God? Don't run off. Listen, let me tell you something. We're charismatic. Word of faith charismatics. I grew up Pentecostal. We believe in the, you know, gifts of the Spirit, manifestations of the Holy Ghost. We believe in the, you know, I believe in prophecy. I believe in the word of wisdom, word of knowledge. I believe in prophecy. I believe in the gifts of healings and working of miracles, you know, in special faith. I believe in, tongues and interpretation of tongues, prophecy. I believe all those things are of God. I believe they're all for the church today. I don't believe God withdrew them. I believe it's what God has for the church today. But I do not believe you need to run off to a prophet conference and get a word to find out what you're supposed to do. Amen. Especially when they're just telling everybody to prophesy over somebody. Turn around, lay your hands on them and prophesy. They might call you something that's in their heart and not in yours. Like I tell people all the time, I went down so-and-so and they prophesied to me, told me I'm supposed to go to Africa as a missionary. I said, go get them. They said, why? Because they're going to have to go with you to tell you and prophesy over you and tell you when you can come back. Amen. Unless you know in your heart what God has for you, you will never be able to stand on somebody else's word. Amen? Amen. I know Paul wrote to Timothy and said, you know, fight a good warfare with the prophecies, but those are words of confirmation, words of encouragement that went before thee. He knew the truth from his mother's womb. His grandmother and his mother were strong Christians in the church. He had grown up. He was walking with God. You go to the book of Acts chapter 13 where it says, separate me. There were certain prophets in the church, and it goes on to list all of them, you know, and Barnabas and Paul, or Saul still at that time. And it says, separate me Barnabas and Saul for the work whereunto I have called them. Now they're already in the ministry. That time there of the laying hands and sending out was not, they weren't walking around minding their business, running a little shop down the road. All of a sudden God says, stop, you know, because someone came out and prophesied in the shop, you need to quit and go do this. Now that's just a word of warning. Doesn't mean you can't walk into that shop and God say, tell them that they need to fulfill what I called them to do, and they're running from the ministry and they know it. That's different. But folks, here's on the receiving end, if you've never thought about it in your life, if it's never been in your heart in your life, you just don't run off and do it. Just because somebody said you're supposed to do it. Hello? I've seen people get married because Sister Matchmaker prophesied over them. Hello? Yay, listen, I know, I got a friend. He got married because they were praying together and prophesied to each other. They're supposed to get married. It didn't last. Hello? Number one, you got to love the person you're going to marry. My goodness. I've seen people get married because people prophesied over them. I've yet to find one that made it. No, wait a second. That they never thought they were going to get married to start with. Come up to so-and-so and so-and-so, and the Lord puts you together in Jesus' name. Oh, I say, I'm the prophet of God. Oh, okay, we got to obey the prophet. They run outside and get married and hate each other. I said, hate each other. Come on now. Like Pastor Hagin said, he always said, I guess he still teaches at marriage class. You know, I graduated in 81, the girls graduated in 2013, and they're still saying the same thing in marriage class. You don't marry a woman just because she's going to enhance your ministry. They teach it in your class? All right. But you all remember, they still taught it in class. If she can sing and play the piano, she'll enhance my ministry. About 2 weeks after you get married, you're going to be at the table, the breakfast table. Now, of course, you have to say it today, looking at your iPad. And you're going to lay it down, look across the table and say, sing, woman, sing. Remind me why I married you, because it ain't because I love the way you look tonight, tomorrow morning, or the next day. But so-and-so prophesied. That's not what prophecy's for. You run around playing Cupid. You think you're Cupid, and you're calling, and then you use thus saith the Lord. Look at how many people got married because I told them to. Now, do some follow-up. How many divorced after they got married? No. If you're going to find the destiny you have in God, there are some things you need to do. Hello. Now, my notes, I've got them a little bit different order, but I'm going to give you this one. How about this? Number one, you do what's at hand. Stop waiting on your ministry and get busy doing something. Come into the church. Do something in the church. Be one of the soul winners. Go out on the soul winning team. Start the soul winning team. I mean, be busy about the kingdom of God. We got people who go to Rhema and stay in Tulsa 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 and stay in Tulsa. What? Waiting on their ministry. When I was out there, man, I was out there and I go to the mall and say, hey, when did you graduate? I graduated 3 years ago. Why are you still here? I'm waiting on my ministry. Pastor, we get up and preach, you know, at school, at graduation. Get away from the command post. We don't need any more folks at the command post. We need you out there in the kingdom. Go do something for Jesus. Come help us. We got a city to take here. Are you here? There's a king. There's a city to take. There's a county to take. There's a region to take for the kingdom. Come to Greensboro. Hook up with us. Run down out of here. Go out and get some folks saved. Help us get the job done. Stop sitting around working at Woodland Hills Mall waiting on your ministry. There are things to do for the kingdom, places to go that people need your help. They can get the kingdom built and the kingdom expanded and reach lives. Did we just die? Oh, okay. Like she's moving her charger. I'm like, oh, no, don't tell me we just died. Ah, she's charging. All right, praise the Lord. Put your hand to what is available. Amen? Romans 2:13. For the hearers of the law are not just before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified. James 1:22. Be doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. Just get busy serving Jesus. Share what God's done with you with people. Well, they don't want to hear it. Tell them anyway. Hello? People are going to come talk to you about stupid stuff. They'll come talk to you about, and they'll start talking about their beer they drink, and, you know, and the craft beer they like, and, you know, and how much they like to drink, and how much they like to smoke, and how much they like to run around with women. And you're like, I don't want that information. Well, here's what I tell you what, buddy. You know, you go ahead and drink your beer. I got something that's better. Man, I get blitzed, man. Hallelujah. You do what it doesn't cost me anything. When it don't cost money, all of a sudden they're really interested. Matter of fact, he's already paid the price. His name is Jesus. Hey! Like John Osteen one time. He went to a football game. And he's sitting out there at that football game. And the guys behind him, they're just, their team's scoring a touchdown. They're cussing and throwing beer and stuff everywhere. You know, and he turned around after a couple minutes and finally said, gentlemen, I'm a preacher. This is my wife. I got my family here. We really don't want to hear your language. And they said, I'm sorry. Next thing good happened. Guy jumped up and went, hallelujah! Reached over and slapped him on the back. Said, how's that, preacher? Well, glory to God. Get busy. Share Jesus. Don't Gloria Copeland. Gloria Osteen. Wow. Boy, you're mixing them up now. Gloria Copeland once said, stop talk to people that act like they believe just like you do. Stop being afraid. Not stop assuming they don't believe anything and start acting like they believe like you do. Because when they walk up and start talking about drinking and running around women and all this kind of stuff, they expect, you're a man, you believe like I do, you live like I do. No, I don't. Number one, I wouldn't have lived long enough to tell you about it. I got a 5'2" Cherokee living in the house. Carries tomahawk. We'll use, all right. So, do what's available. Be a doer, don't be a listener. Don't be a sitter. Be active. Get out there into the highways and byways and compel them to come in. Stop acting like, you know, if I talk, well, there's two things we don't talk about around here is politics and religion. They talk about politics and religion all the time. They just don't want to hear what you got to say. Those who are persuasion of the anti-constitutional, the Lenin, Marxist, secular humanist crowd will talk about their garbage all day long. And they'll talk about their atheism and their lack of belief in anything. They'll talk about the transcendental meditation. They'll talk about Buddhism. They'll talk about Hinduism. They'll talk about anything. They don't want to hear about Jesus. And you're not supposed to say that. Get busy sharing the truth. Why? Because what you have is anointed by God. What you have is anointed by the Holy Ghost. What you have will destroy yokes and remove burdens. Glory to God. You'll set the captives free. Praise God. You may not get every last one of them, but the ones you do get, glory be to God. When you go fishing, you don't always catch all the fish, but maybe you're looking for the fish you do get. Glory to God. I know some people who fish. They'll sit there all day long to get one fish. They'll get a little one. We'll caught something. Hello? They'll sit there all day long and catch nothing. But they were happy because they were fishing. Jesus said, I come to make you fishers of men. Stop waiting for the glorious ministry. Stop waiting for your book tour. Stop waiting for all your television program and get busy serving God. Hallelujah. God can't steer a sitting car. However, your car is parked in that parking lot right now. You can go sit down in there, get your keys so you can turn the wheel, and you can turn it as far this way as you want, and then turn around and turn that far that way you want, and it won't change directions. Until it is moving, you can't steer it. Come on. When you're at the helm of a ship, they can sit there and dock all day long. Go get the captain's wheel. And those rudders could just go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And that ship ain't going nowhere and ain't changing directions. When it's tied up at the dock. It's moored. It's not going anywhere. But put it to sea. And turn that wheel. What's happening? It's a moving ship. The rudder will now change direction. God cannot bring you to where you need to be unless you're moving with Him and for Him. God can do anything. He can't make you do something you're not doing. Hello? If you're going to outrun the chariots, you're going to have to gird up your skirt and start running. Amen. Can you say amen? Another very important thing is, if you, and I know the last one we're going to get to is going to be good, but if you're ever going to be able to know how God is leading you, you need to be a student of the Word. Because you can't go by goosebumps. Now, listen, I know Pentecostals. I grew up Pentecostal. I came over among the Charismatics. What's that? Pentecostals from other denominations. That's all they were. My pastor told me one time, he said, yeah, if you took all the Charismatics, Pentecostals, put them in the back, shook them up, not that, you wouldn't be able to tell them apart. Even if they had been an Episcopal or a Lutheran or a Presbyterian or a Catholic or a Baptist or whatever, they got baptized in the Holy Ghost, they became a Charismatic, they wouldn't be called associated with the denomination. But they said, same bunch. You'll get into some of the same problems. Woo! I felt a goosebump. That's God. It might have been cold. Hello? You might have got a chill. It wasn't anything to do with the Holy Ghost. So what happens? The Word of God will keep us grounded and stable and steadfast and won't let us be moved by little whoos. You can be charismatic, Word of Faith, Pentecostal, and not be weird. You don't have to walk around looking like Ka from the Jungle Book. Trust in me. How many ever seen the Jungle Book? Ka hypnotizes everybody, you know? You got a lot of charismatic Word of Faith Pentecostal people walk around like that all the time. Everybody thinks you're weird. You don't have to be weird to be spiritual. Hello? You don't have to be wild-eyed. Come on now. 2 Timothy 2:15 says this, study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. What does this tell us? When we know what the Word of God says, when something flaky comes along, we'll know it's flaky. And we'll be able to discern it because the Word of God teaches against being flaky. I don't believe granola Christianity is biblical. That is fruits, nuts, and flakes all put together in the same package. And see, I can say this. See, now if a non-Pentecostal said this, you'd be mad at him. But I'm Pentecostal. And let me say something. They can say it, and they're right. Like I heard Jerry Savelle say one time. He said, let's face it, folks. There's some squirrels in the camp. Hello? There's some squirrels in the camp. Well, this is why we must be students of the Word. We have to rightly divide the Word of truth. And just because something floated by and you got shivers from it doesn't mean it's God. Well, how am I going to know if it's God? You got to know what the Word says so you can measure it against the written Word. I said, you got to know what the Word says so you can measure it against the written Word. Peter wrote to the church and said this. He said, we were with Jesus in the when he was transfigured in the mount. I'm paraphrasing just a little bit. In the glorious mount. And then he came right behind that and said this. But we having a more sure word of prophecy. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and it's profitable. For reproof, for rebuke, for instruction, for reproof, correction and righteousness, correction, instruction and righteousness, and doctrine. Sorry, for doctrine, for reproof, for correction and instruction and righteousness. He said that the written word is more sure than Jesus appearing and speaking to you. You go stand in the glory. I've heard from heaven. Are y'all here? See, when you know what the Word says, then you will know when something is not right. Your heart might be telling you, but because somebody said, the Lord said. See, young Christians can get just led astray just because somebody said, God told me. Hello? God showed me. You're supposed to marry so-and-so. Yeah, they're already married. Had somebody call me on the phone one time. I want to talk to the pastor. Okay, yeah, all right. What's going on? Well, I need help. All right, what is it? Well, there's this man in the church that the Lord showed me I'm supposed to marry in a dream. Oh, okay. Y'all ever talk? Nope. Ever dated? Nope. But I know the Lord showed me I'm supposed to marry him. Really? Well, have you made any pursuing to try to get to know him at all? No? Huh. Well, can I ask you a question? Yeah. Why didn't you go to your pastor or the leadership in your church to talk to him about it? I can't talk to him about it. Really? Yep. Why? He's married. Now, before I could stop myself. It came and I said, sister, you had too much pizza last night because that was an indigestion dream. God's not involved in that. God's not going to call you to go marry another man, another woman's husband. Hello. Oh, we're supposed to be together. No, you're not. And you're in lust and you're in mental adultery. Because Jesus said to look on another man, another woman, to lust after her is to commit adultery already in your heart. Don't tell me God, I know God, no God didn't. Yeah, he did. Yeah, he did. I'm sorry, God did. Little G, Beelzebub, the maggot God. The God of your flesh. You thought she looked good, or you thought he looked good, and you laid your eyes on him, and you calling around churches trying to get some minister to give you the go-ahead. Without giving them all the information. Because you know it's wrong. That's why she couldn't go to her leadership. Because she would have got rebuked and probably put out of the church. But what she was looking for was somebody to tell her, yeah, that's God. Go ahead, girl. Without having all the information, she would go back to church. I called a man of God. And he gave me the okay to go after that man. Ain't going to put it off on me. No, you ain't. You don't get away with that one. I hear from heaven. That's why I kept getting these questions to ask her. Now, when you know the Word of God, well, the Lord hates adultery. The Lord hates divorce. It doesn't mean He can't forgive you for divorce, but He sure ain't going to condone you doing it in the process and tell you, go for it, baby. Excuse me. Do we have the glory coming around? All right, hallelujah. I'm being silly. Once you know what the Word of God says, but we just got to believe God to get into a permanent location again. Because I really like this place. I really enjoy being here, but I'm telling you, it's running out of time. It's that time thing. I'm just warming up. Once you're putting you're a student of the Word, you're putting your hand to whatever is available, listen to the voice of your recreated human spirit. Now, why did I put the knowing the Word first? Because if you don't know what the Word says, your spirit can be an ineffective guide. Because you don't have anything to measure off of or judge off of. Let me say this. If you're getting something and you're not sure, you can come to your pastor. Now, I'm not going to say God said and God didn't say, but I can point you to it. Now, look, if you came to me and said, God, somebody's supposed to marry somebody else's husband, I would say, no, that's not God. Because the Word says. See, my answer would be because the Word says. We had a girl a number of years ago. She had come down to our hometown, to the university there, to go to school. And we had gotten, because I was assistant pastor, and in the time that she was there at that school, we moved to Greensboro and took the church here in Greensboro and started pastoring here in Greensboro. Well, she was from this area. High Point, Thomasville, somewhere right adjacent to us. And so she had come home. Well, she went, she was living back at home, and she would come visit the church some. And but she got off down to another state to one of these prophet meetings where they're launching all these prophets to the nations, just launching prophets. And she got a word. She's supposed to go do this and go do this, marry this person, do all this, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. She bought it. She came back. Oh, I'm going to go to Pastor Ed and have him here and let him tell me what he thinks. So I listened to it, because they had their personal prophecy taped. And I'm not against recording stuff, and if somebody gets a word that's a legitimate thing, people can write them down, they can hear it again, that's fine. But you got to judge it. And I said, okay. It's generic enough that, it could apply to anybody on the planet. Hello. I said, let me ask you a question. Okay. Before you went to this meeting, and before they lined you up and they laid hands on you and they said, yeah, the Lord says to go do this, go do that. I said, had you ever had it in your heart before that day to do any of that? No. 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 You mean that you never envisioned or never had it in your spirit or anything like that, that you would go be a missionary somewhere? Mm-mm. Well, how about now? Well, they gave me that word. See, they really still didn't have it in their heart. They were trying to obey the prophecy and not be led by the Spirit. They that are led by the Spirit of God are the sons of God. Now they're led by prophecy. I believe in prophecy, but I don't believe it's going to be accurate, it's going to be of God, when it's telling people they're going to be doing stuff they ain't never had in their heart to go do. So I set them aside. I said, listen, here's what you need to do. I said, you never had this in your heart a day one before this. Nope. I said, I'd go put it on the back shelf, and I'd just leave it there. I wouldn't make any plans in that direction. I wouldn't make any decisions to go in that direction. I wouldn't do anything in my life to get in that direction. And unless the Lord puts it in your heart that that's what you're supposed to do, I'd never pick it up again. They didn't like what I said. They got in the car, drove all the way back to our hometown to the church we had been in. Made an appointment with the pastor. Took it into him. Played it for him. Said, I played it for Pastor Ed. What did he say? He told me to put it on the back shelf and leave it alone. Sounds like he gave you pretty good advice to me. That's what he told her. You are not led. People will prophesy stuff to you that's in their heart. When I say prophesy, I'm using that loosely. They'll say the Lord's telling you to do stuff that's really in their heart. Or just their opinion about what you should be doing. That's why it's so important to be know what the Word says. And then, listen, if you get something and you're struggling with it, you come to your pastor. Now, listen, we're not talking about discipleship or, where you can't get a job unless I give you permission to get a job. Shepherding, thank you, that crazy stuff. We're saying that there's counsel and there's wisdom available you can bounce it off of, and we can come let us reason together. Okay? Around the Word of God. Get godly counsel. Instead of making a decision because somebody walks around and they act like they and they'll work against pastors. No, don't. I've had people tell me, don't share this with your pastor. He won't understand. I'm sorry. I walk in the Spirit. I know the voice of the Holy Ghost. I've walked in places. Hello? I know when God's saying stuff. And I'm not perfect, but I know when God's saying stuff when He ain't. Hello? That mean I'm your guy, but I'm a sounding board. He won't understand. That why? They want to protect their ministry. You should never have anything that can't be judged by other seasoned ministers in the kingdom. If it's God, it'll stand the test of being judged. It will withstand the scrutiny of being analyzed spiritually. If it's God. Now, if it's flaky, it'll crumble and burn up. Hello? Can I get an amen off the internet? Can I get a happy, smiley, I love it face? Listen to the voice of your recreated human spirit. 1 Kings 19. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and withal how he had slain the prophets with the sword. Now, think about this. Elijah calls all the prophets out. 450 prophets of Baal. Gives them days to cut themselves and to sacrifice and to pray to their God, and to get the fire come down and lick up their sacrifice. Nothing. He says, now look, guys, I'm going to really show you out. Build a trough around this. Go get X number of firkins of water, whatever it was. I mean, it's a barrels of water. Pour it all over the sacrifice. Now, why? Because in that day, what they really had was, in some place they had trap doors where they would send fire out and consume the sacrifices to deceive the people. He said, soak it. Are you here? And he poured water all over it. They poured water all over everything. There's just water standing there. He prays just a little bit, and boom, it's gone. The God answers by fire is God. And then he proceeds to take them all out. One little prophet takes out 450 guys. I mean, it's like a Lord of the Rings scene. Hello? Yeah, they're gone. All by himself. All by myself. Anyway, he does it all by himself. You never know what song's going to flow out of here. Anyway. And word reaches Jesse, the whore of the kingdom. Well, as you've done to my prophet, so shall I do to you by this time tomorrow. Now, wait. See, when you're in the anointing, you can do things you can't do in the flesh. See, the anointing was on him. When he did that, he got out from under that anointing, and he's back to being a man. And she makes a threat, and he gets weenified. He gets spaghetti noodle spine. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and with all how he had slain all the prophets with the sword. And she sent a messenger. So let the gods do to me, and more also, if thou make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time. And when he saw that, he arose, went for his life. He should have just picked up the sword and said, I'm coming after you next. She would have run. She's already heard he's killed 450. And came to Beersheba, which belongeth to Judah, and left his servant there. He himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down on a juniper tree. And he requested for himself that he might die. He's going hee-haw on us. Gloom, despair, and agony on me. I served you, Lord, faithfully. Hello? Are you here? Then the going got tough. And I got rough. Gloom, despair, agony on me. Kill me, God! Oh, he's over there whining. Just a couple days before, he'd come 450 people by himself, calling fire down out of heaven, licking up water, stones, and everything. And now all of a sudden, he can't take on one little whore. Hello? You say, Pastor, that's what she was. Don't dress it up. All right, she's a skank. You call her a skank? Pastor, are you kidding me? What should we call her? Not a nice person. Morally challenged. Okay. Since I don't believe in PC, we're going to go with what I said. For I'm not better than, take away my life, I'm not better than my father's. And as he lay, he slept under a juniper tree. Behold, then an angel touched him, and he said unto him, arise and eat. He needed strength for his journey. And he looked, and behold, there was a cake baking on the coals and a cruse of water at his head. He did eat and drink and laid him down again. And the angel came unto him the second time, touched him, and said, arise, eat, because the journey is too great for thee. Now, what's he need? He needs spiritual food. Now, we're just going to take a little side journey right here. After great victories in the spirit, you can't just quit. You've got to go back and get refilled. And you see, that's what the angel's doing. He was getting refilled because he needed to be filled back up. If you're going to be consistent when battles, you need to stay full. You're not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be ye being filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, making melody in your heart to the Lord. You got to stay constantly filled. Amen? Hallelujah. And he arose and ate and went the strength of that meat 40 days and nights under Oreb, the mount of God. Came thither into a cave and lodged there, and behold, the word of the Lord came unto him and said unto him, what doest thou here, Elijah? He said, I've been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, for the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altars, slain thy prophets with the sword, and I only. Where, oh, where are you tonight? Why did you leave me here all alone? He's all alone. I searched the world over, thought I found true love. You met another, and pfft, you was gone. Elijah's in the cave. I'm all by myself. Anyway. They slain the prophets, I only, and left, and they seek my life to take it away. He said, go forth and stand upon the mount before the Lord, and behold, the Lord passed by. Now remember, this word is four caps. It is Yahweh. It's YHWH, Yahweh, Jehovah. It is the God of the covenant. So, and the God of the covenant came. Amen. And behold, the Lord passed by with a great and strong wind, rent the mountains and break it into pieces with the rocks before the Lord. And the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a still small voice. And it was so that Elijah heard it. That he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood in the entering of the cave and said, and behold, there came a voice unto him and said, what doest thou here, Elijah? He said, I've been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts because the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altar, slain thy prophets with the sword, and I am only left, and they seek my life to take it away. He said, and the Lord said, go return thy way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when thou comest, anoint Hazael to be king over Syria. He goes on, and one thing he says there, I've reserved 7,000 unto myself that have not bowed their knee to Baal. See, you might think you're by yourself, but you're not by yourself. You think you're the only one obeying God, but you're not the only one obeying God. You keep doing what you're supposed to do. God's not going to leave you comfortless. God's not going to leave you helpless. God's not going to leave you all by yourself. And he ain't going to put up with you whining and being depressed about it. get up from there and shake yourself and get back into what you're supposed to do. Here's your job. Go anoint him. Can you say amen? I said, can you say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. So we need to understand, you've got to listen to the voice of your spirit. If you're not listening to the voice of your spirit, you'll listen to all kinds of voices. How do I know it's my spirit? How do I know God's talking through my spirit to me? You know what the word says. Hello? Had somebody tell me one time that if, you know, they'd gone through the things I'd gone through in the church, they'd have moved. They'd have gone somewhere else. Hello? Verse 18 says, yet I have left me 7,000 in Israel, all the knees which have not bowed their knee to Baal, and every mouth which has not kissed him. I tell people sometimes, they say, well, you know, why would you stay under some of those circumstances? Because God told me to go. And you know what? I found out that the God who told me to come here can still tell me to leave if he needs for me to. And I've given him the opportunity. Hey, sure you don't want me over here? There's a great church looking for a pastor. They got hundreds and hundreds of people, you know? Now, I haven't done that in a long time. Because I finally settled at some point in this journey. I finally settled. Until God tells me to move, I ain't moving. I'm open to him telling me to move. But if he doesn't tell me to move, I ain't moving. Yeah, but nothing. Yeah, but I got all these dreams. Listen, there are things I will do and do again and do I've never done before I go home to be with the Lord. And it doesn't look like it's going to happen any time in the next week or two. But I will do them. I will do them. I'll travel in Europe again and go preach in Bible schools again. Pretty much have an open invitation to go to any Bible school that we have anywhere in the world anytime we want to go. Hello? There's things in my heart to do. But the biggest thing in my heart is the church. The other things will come. I said they will come in due season. Yeah, but, you know, my ministry is so important, I got to get something. One preacher said one time, he don't go to small churches because he's got to maximize his ministry. Unless the Lord spoke to him, I wouldn't have him in my church. And he's big. I mean, people would love to have him. You'd fill the place up. And I ain't talking about, you'd fill big buildings up. I got to maximize my ministry. The maximization of your ministry is doing what God told you to do. And I've got Bible for mine, you don't for yours. God took Philip right out of the middle of a citywide revival and sent him to the desert to get one Ethiopian eunuch saved. Get one dude saved. Oh, I can't leave. I got to maximize my ministry. We got a healing thing going on here. We're stacking up crutches and stretchers and stuff. People are getting healed. Maine are getting whole. I mean, it's such a big revival. Peter and John are coming down from Jerusalem to get them filled with the Holy Ghost. Woo! I can't leave yet. He walks right out of that middle of that citywide meeting and goes out in the desert and gets one guy saved. But because he obeyed God, he got to have the first Beam Me Up Scotty event. Hello? He came up out of the water from baptizing the guy, and he was found 30 miles away. The guy just kind of looked around, he's gone, got in his chariot and took off. Hello? I'm sure it's going something like this. Dun, 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 dun. You remember Chariots of Fire? Nathan's like, what? So it was a musical. Hallelujah. It was not a verbal song. All right. Praise God. God has a plan for you. God has a plan for you. God can speak through people, but it should confirm what's already there and not tell you something you've never thought of. You should know the Word of God so that you know, you got to be careful about little hoofs. And the way we can judge is what the Word says. What does the Word say? And if you're young and immature in the Lord, don't know enough, that's why good pastors are important in your life. Because we can take you to the Word. Not just my opinion. What does the Word say about this? Let's go find out what the Bible says about what you're saying. Hello? So we can have an assurance. We want you to follow God. We want you to follow God because you're confident in it. Now, I can tell you this. See, I knew the Word. I knew God. I've been to Rhema. I graduated. I was working in the ministry when God called us here. And when God spoke to us supernaturally, I knew it was God because I'd already been in places with God and been in His Spirit and been around Him, but been in the Word. I learned the voice of God and was able to judge it because I knew what the Word said. And when He spoke to us, He spoke something that I did not in my theological perspectives would have not ever thought of on my own. Pastor had cancer. He said to me in February of that year, he will die and you will go and take that church. And I didn't tell anybody. If I remember, I don't even know if I told my wife because it messed me up. Well, Lord, everybody's praying for him to be healed. Everybody's praying for him to be healed. You know, what are you? I just kept it silent. You remember the Bible says that Mary pondered all those things in her heart? And I just sat there because I've been called to ask her to come up and to fill in for a service while they were out of town. In Tulsa, getting ministered to, but they left and came back, and they called me and said, "We don't need for you to go." He just couldn't. He wouldn't stay. He had to get back to his people. Hey, pastors, if you are struggling, you need help, get help. You're not going to be any help to your people if you don't get help. Hello, if you're not sound, you're not going to be able to be sound for your people. Hello, that was in February, March, April, 1st of May, he died. 2 weeks later, we get a phone call from the home office of our a group we were ordained with. It wasn't Rainbow, but it was another one. And talked to the pastor, said, we need somebody to go to Greensboro and fill in for this guy. He said, well, I've got Ed. He can go. He said, that's who I wanted to go. Okay. So I came. Next week, somebody else came. And then after they called, said, we just want him to go all the time. For several weeks, that was May, by the third or fourth week of May, I was coming every Sunday. Jane and I would drive up on Friday, on Saturday, spend the night Saturday night, preach on Sunday, and then drive back Sunday night. Okay, they put us in a hotel. We would just go come and preach every weekend. By August, they came and said, "Well, what are you going to do about that church?" I said, "I've known since February I was supposed to take that church." What? Yeah, the Lord told me in February He was going to die. I was going to take the church, but I didn't want to say anything. I was just letting it work itself out. I was just letting it happen. Well, Pastor Harrison, Brother Buddy, and myself, we think you're supposed to. I know. But I just want to let it prove itself out without, me going. Now, let me tell you something. That was such a strong event in my life. I've never questioned whether or not I was supposed to be here. I knew it was God. It proved itself out. I let it prove itself out without making it happen. I didn't go around blabbing my mouth. He's going to die and I'm taking the church. I just kept that quiet. I kept that in my heart. See, some things you can't just run your flat jaw mouth about. You'll mess everything up. When you're being led by God, being led by the Spirit, there's things you're going to just ponder in your heart, or you get counsel. If you're young, and I was older. I'd been in ministry now a number of years and had been to Bible school. I'd been around the things. I'd been trained. I'd been developed. Doesn't mean I don't ever go get counsel, but it's one of those events that I knew. It measured against the Word of God that, I'm being led by this, but I knew it was going to happen. It wasn't God's plan. It wasn't God's will, but, certain things have been set in motion that didn't get changed. Couldn't be changed. And sometimes there are reasons you'll never know why until we get to heaven. And then we get to heaven. It's like Brother Hagin's sister told me he had that vision. She said, "Oh, Kenneth, don't worry about it. You couldn't get me healed." There are reasons, and never told him. Why? Because the secret thing belongs to the Lord, and that's what you revealed to 1,000 generations. Well, we believe in healing. We got to get everybody healed. There's some things sometimes you can't override, like unbelief or their will. Some people want to go home. You can't get people healed who don't want to be healed, who just want to go home. And unless you change that, you can't fix it. I don't care what you... I'm going to pray them out. Not if they don't want it. Amen? Oh, my. Okay. Everybody say, glory be to God.
Glory be to God.
We're running out of time. We got to get out of here. All right. We love you. Call us at 336-852-0088 if you need something. If you need for us to pray with you, agree with you. Amen.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fvc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.